everyone this morning on this beautiful day. So you can feel the spirit blowing today, waving through the cornfields and things, cooling off those who are harvesting tobacco. Which has always amazed me because I went to a seminary in Louisville, Kentucky, and would drive up to the Cincinnati area of northern Kentucky for my student position my first year and talk about the tobacco harvest and stuff. Then I moved to Wisconsin, and I think of Dairyland and not tobacco. But it's been interesting to watch that. And I know Carrie Bettenhausen, if we were really good, faithful church members supporting her, we'd be in the tobacco field today. She was recruiting people to come out and help. Al says no. Anyhow, you've been there and done that. Kind of like, actually, it looks harder than bailing. Okay? So. Anyhow, it's good to have everyone this morning. We have fellowship afterwards. Stay and enjoy that. Thank you to those who provided food. We're without mics right now. We've been trying to figure out, it's not picking up, so we're going to have that looked at. So, anyhow, I'm going to talk loud, and Bud Rumpf has no problem talking loud. He's a former middle school teacher. So, anyhow, we apologize for that, and bear with us. Speaking of middle school, next week we are going to have a blessing of the backpacks and students and teachers. So with school beginning, just trying to acknowledge that time of the year. And then as we get into September with kind of a gathering, a homecoming kickoff Sunday for Sunday school and things. So those are coming up in the next few weeks. And with back to school, one of the things I've been doing, just to keep you informed, because I know we as a church provide one of the meals down at Press House, but for the last 6 years now, I've been grilling down there. Scott Anderson and I go down and we're the grill masters for their big kickoff on their first regular worship, and it's always a great ministry to be a part of. So anyhow, keep us in your prayers and all the new students who are heading back. Those are the announcements I have for the ministry and mission of our church. Are there any others today?
Could just add Press House, the meal we'll be taking will be November 1st.
November 1st. That'll be good. And they have a new, the kitchen and fellowship is now in the basement. They reclaimed that space and remodeled it and expanding as their ministry is expanding. So, anyhow, wonderful things. If nothing else, let us worship.
Stand in your very presence and behold you face to face. And so we have come to this place today. We have gathered together to worship you, to offer the praise which belongs to you alone.
Bless us as we worship you together, and as we open our hearts and minds to your presence among us, in others, and throughout the world.
For you alone are God, the one in whom we trust. Amen. Continuing with our opening hymn, number 554. Let all things know it. Hear this good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ came for us. Christ lived for us. Christ died for us. Christ rose again in power for us. The scriptures declare that if any person be in Christ, that person becomes a whole new being. The old is dead and gone, and in Christ, all people, all things are made new. Thanks be to God for this good news of the gospel. Amen.
Thank you.
hearts.
To this peace we are called as members of a single body.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share Christ's peace with one another.
Peace be with you.
Anyhow, Jared, you. Good to see you. Al, peace. I really don't like that talk. Hey, good morning. Hey,
there's a big tree.
It's like full.
Good.
And pencils away. There won't be any quiz today after the reading. Anyway, we're moving on to our first reading, which is Psalms 84, located on page 543 in the Old Testament. And of course, the Psalms are probably one of the most read, definitely in the Old Testament, because almost every one of their little chapters has some beautiful words to it. This happened to be the third book, if you take Psalms into portions, which were the chapters 73 through 89, and our Psalm 84, 1 through 12, is in that section. Also, you'll find a very similar message is found in the Psalm, in the 27th Psalm. So, the joy of worship in the temple, the 84th Psalm. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for the joy of the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars. O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise, Salah. Happy are those whose strength is in you and whose heart are the highways to Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs, and early rain also covers it with pools. They call from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Salah. Behold our shield, our God. Look for the face of your anointment. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. He bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord without withhold from those who walk uprightly. For Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you.
Thank you, Bud. Our second reading is taken from the Gospel of John. We'll be reading in chapter 6, verse 56 through 69. Together we continue in this teaching in John about Jesus as the bread of life. And today he speaks words that are confusing and still confusing all these days later about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. Much discussion around that and how challenging and troubling that can be for those who follow and even is in this reading and us today. So together, let us listen for what the Spirit is saying. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. And when many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you, there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe, and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." For the Word of God in Scripture, for the Word of God among us, for the Word of God within us, we give thanks to God. Bud was kidding. There is a quiz.
What songs did I read today?
Yeah. Oh, that's the first question.
That's the first question. I got the right answer.
Really? All right. Mark did lean over whispering. If you would. Please join with me in a moment for silence, for prayer and preparation. Lord, whom to can we go? For you have the words that give us spirit and life. And we give thanks to you. May that word nourish us this day, filling us, challenging us, calling us forward always in loving service as Christ loved us. So last week I was really angry. This week, I want to share a fantasy that I have. I mean, I've been fantasizing about it a lot. And, well, my fantasy involves my neighbors. A little embarrassed to say. I suppose in confessing this from the pulpit, I'm in violation of one of the Ten Commandments. I guess, since I'm being honest with you, I have to tell you that it involves lust in that fantasy. My wife doesn't like it when I talk about my fantasy with her. I mean, who could blame her? I obsess over it. I Google pictures about it. I watch it on television when she and Sam aren't around. Like a tearful Jimmy Swagger. I have sinned coveting my neighbor's RV. I mean, every day I walk by, parked in their driveway, and I think about hot wiring it and taking it for a joyride. Different from your youth, you know. So there's another Ten Commandment I'm in violation of. But if I really am honest, my fantasy, and this is what Stacy doesn't like, is to buy one and hit the road. Now, I'm not talking about any old RV. I want one of those million-dollar babies I've seen on those shows on television. I mean, have you ever seen how luxurious those things are? It's like living in a mansion inside. And, of course, my RV would be my dwelling place. And I mean my dwelling place because it's not Stacy and Sam. They have no desire to drive around in one even for a weekend, let alone live in one, though we have talked to Sam about maybe, and this is where Stacy would concede, buying one so we could park in front of his dorm room. I mean, they've seen, and maybe you have too, that Robin Williams movie, RV, and thanks but no thanks. And that's being kind sometimes to me. Personally, I think Abraham should have bargained with God for an RV when in Genesis 12 God speaks to him and calls him to leave his family and head out to a new place that God will show him. And perhaps the Israelites would not have complained to Moses so much about wandering in the wilderness all those years if they'd all been in RVs. And what about Jesus and his disciples? Forget the boat. 12 disciples riding around in an RV with Jesus, maybe with a giant I Heart Jesus painted on the side. Now that'd be really worth following, wouldn't it? But I think the one that really could have benefited from a mega million-dollar luxurious RV would have been God. I mean, the Ark of the Covenant would not need to have been housed in a tent. It could have been magnificently displayed with windows all around the RV, a spectacular light and smoke show with a special shofar to a horn to announce the arrival of God as it was driven from place to place by the people, on view for all people to see. Wouldn't that be lovely? psalmist might think so, as the psalmist sings out, "How lovely is your dwelling place, the Lord of hosts." Doug Bratt, connected to the Calvin Seminary in Michigan, says in a post in the text this week, Psalm 84, in it, the poet expresses her love and longing to visit God's dwelling place. In fact, he longs to be in God's courts, and that longing is so deep that he insists that it fills his soul, heart, and flesh. In other words, his whole being. God's lovely dwelling place was indeed a tent. For many years, carried and carted literally around by the Hebrew people, special individuals within that larger community, through the wilderness for all those years on their way to that promised land. And inside the tent, in what is described as the Holy of Holies that only priests could enter, the Ark of the Covenant was placed there. And there it resided for close to 400 years. Now, as we know, King David, who first brought the Ark of the Covenant into the city of David, which we know as Jerusalem today, it was also David who, in a dream, had this idea, this vision that he believed was from God, that of a permanent dwelling place for the Ark of the Covenant, and therefore for God, a house of worship. How lovely it is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. Of course, David didn't get to build the temple. His son Solomon did. And in 1 Kings, in chapter 6, in verses 11 through 13, God says to Solomon, "Now concerning this house that you are building, if you will walk in my statutes and obey my ordinances and keep all my commandments by walking in them, then I will establish my promise with you, which I made to your father David. I will dwell among the children of Israel and will not forsake my people, Israel." God's dwelling place, based on the description in 1 Kings and in 2 Chronicles in chapter 3, was indeed lovely. That was until it was destroyed by King Nebuchadnezzar II. And while it was built years later, today all that remains of God's lovely dwelling place that the psalmist pines for in our reading today is a wall. And that wall is known today as the Wailing Wall and is visited by thousands of people every year. Maybe some of you have been there. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts, sings the psalmist. It is suggested based on these next verses here, where the psalmist says, "My soul longs, indeed it faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise." As I said, it's been suggested that the writer of this psalm, based on these words, was unable, for whatever reason, to make it to the temple, to the house of the Lord, to worship. Today, there are a lot of people, as we know, who cannot make it to the lovely dwelling place of the Lord of hosts for reasons only known to them. Of course, many people would propose for reasons about the drop in Sunday worship attendance that it has to do with work schedules or sports commitments or family commitments or social gatherings or apathy, health issues. The list goes on and on. It has been researched and dissected and discussed and blogged about and lamented by many, even us, as to why this is so. I wonder if this is why they call that last remnant of the wall of the temple the Wailing Wall. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. This past Tuesday at the meeting of the John Knox Presbytery, we were discussing Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah, in chapter 29, verses 4 through 7, which deals with the second exile, or the Babylonian exile. The only place that these people had ever known to worship God was in that lovely dwelling place of Solomon's temple. But now it had been destroyed, and they'd been carted off to live in exile in Babylon. And the question was, where were they going to worship God? And how would they worship God now? The temple's destroyed. Their traditions, their rituals are all gone because of that. But God answers them through the prophet Jeremiah. And that answer was very simple. Bloom where you are planted. Or as Jeremiah put it, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare you will find your wealth. Bloom where you are planted. So let me ask you this. Where would we worship if this building was no longer here? Or if you could no longer make it up to this church? Like Israelites living in exile, some theorize that we are living in exile. Exile from a past some of us knew and longed for again. Church was overflowing with people and programs. And yet here we are with decreasing numbers and financial struggles and constant building upkeep. And we know the struggles of that. And we ask, where does God dwell? If not in a building, in a lovely house of worship, our lovely sanctuary, and it is lovely. Where does God dwell? Is it in a megachurch with all the bells and whistles and programs that come with it? Could it be in a coffee shop? A diner? A soccer field? A hospital? A care facility? Could it be in the checkout line at the pig? Or a family gathering down at Lake Ripley in the park? Could it be on social media and Facebook? Maybe yes. Many people theorize that that is so. And why not, based on Matthew 18, 20, where two or three are gathered in my name, Jesus says, there I am also. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. What we know is where God dwells is not just in a building. It is in a community of believers where they have gathered, two or three or more. So if we gather in a building, in this building, God is present. But not because of this building, but rather because of us. God is present in us and among us, and through us, in every place we gather. John Cowan, in his book, The Common Table, says that in the Hindu tradition, they greet each other by bowing with folded hands against the breast stone. This ceremony means, I salute the divinity within you. Now, Cowan goes on to say, no workplace, school, neighborhood, community, church, can ever truly be alive until we see the divinity within one another, until we experience behind the breast stone the breath of life, until we insist that our work will not be the humdrum product of a sleeping spirit, but a glorious monument to who we really are. And who we really are is the dwelling place of God. For the past several weeks, and we did it last summer, we've been singing these words. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. A lovely dwelling place, a sanctuary. And where is God's lovely dwelling place that we long for? Is it in a tent, like it was at one point in the past, or in Solomon's temple, or is it a church building? Or has it always been in the midst of the people of God, created in God's own image? Wherever they find themselves, wandering in the wilderness, living in Egypt, out on the streets, in the pig at Lake Ripley, wherever we are, or two or three again. No matter where we find ourselves, friends, in a church on a Sunday morning like we are, safe in the pew we always sit in, surrounded by the familiar faces of people we know and love, or removed from here because of work or health or family commitments, the presence of God's Spirit is alive in each person, in every place, in all experiences of life. And that's what makes it God's lovely dwelling place that we long for. Like the songs. If you ask me, that's worth bowing to, honoring, and worshiping every day. Now, isn't that lovely? Sharing our lives through our prayers, lifting one another up, offering them up in joy and in concern for one another. Mary, it's good to have you back with us. And Dick, I know you continue with your health issues, and we were discussing some of those. Dick, for your care, but also Mary, with your mother and her health in its decline. So for Mary and Dick, for all who struggle with health issues, for those who care for them, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Are there others today? Yes.
We can have prayers for the people out west, especially in the Idaho and Washington area. My husband's sister died, and due to the air control and the problems that they're having, the family hadn't been able to get up into Mattress, Oregon. The family has been evacuated. Post Falls, Idaho, can't leave her home. And it's a very sad time for my husband because he isn't going to be able to go. He isn't going to be able to fly and take the chance to fly into Spokane. So that whole area there, we can keep
those fires,
those fires are horrible.
Devastating to many people on many levels. Interesting you mentioned that, and prayers for the firefighters. When we lived in Monroe, across the street was a young boy, who was probably about 5, 6 years old, and his mom just sent me a friend request, and Skyler is one of the firefighters in Idaho. He lives in Arizona, but he's been shot up there for that. Interesting to make a connection. So for those, because of fires and other things that are causing all kinds of issues, and for those who are fighting those, for those who've lost their lives, some of the firefighters have, and other people within that, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
I want to raise, go ahead.
For the health of my first grandchild, expecting next weekend.
Why you won't be here. So congratulations for that, for the birth, for those who walk that journey, for the mom and those who care for the newborns, for that. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for mothers, as I was thinking, received an email, and I know they work with special ed and special needs children in the school districts in McFarland. And one of my young, not young anymore, mothers from the youth group down in Monroe has a child 5 who has severe autism. And she, like the psalmist, lamenting, she wants to go to the house of the Lord. She wants to worship, but she's struggling bringing a child because she can't sit and care for that. And it's exhausting. So we're all parents in the midst of that. As they struggle and how we as a community of faith can be supportive. For all these, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Are there others today? For these, we lift up one another, the ones we've mentioned, but the ones that are still on our hearts, and the world in which we live. Let us join in a time of silence for prayer and then the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. God, we have gathered in your name, in this place, in this sanctuary, and our hearts do sing for joy, for being in your presence. And you have opened our hearts and our lives and our eyes to see your presence, not just in the building, but in each other. And as we have lifted up our concerns this day for those facing birth, for the struggles that come, for those who on their journey are facing other health issues, for those in life dealing with natural disasters, with fires out in the West and other places. Those who grieve, we give thanks to you for your presence that strengthens us, that heals us, and brings us forward always in your name. You are the bread of life, and in you we are nourished, and in you, Lord, we find a spirit that helps us to live, to care, to bring hope and healing to all. And we pray this in the name of the one whose spirit we gather in, the Christ, who taught his disciples, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
continue in our morning worship as we respond to God's love and care through the giving of our gifts, tithes, and offerings. I invite our ushers.
Amen.
go ahead. So you're having a grandchild and another lady?
Yeah, a little boy.